This is Chris Kirkland from Tokyo Cheapo, and you're listening to Barefoot Radio.
Fire your boss, sell your car, travel the world. You're listening to Barefoot Radio with your host, Graham Brown.
Buy your boss, sell your car, travel the world. You're listening to Barefoot Radio, and today we're heading to Tokyo to meet world traveler, entrepreneur, author, radio show host, musician, hobo CEO, Chris Kirkland. We're going to learn about life as a hobo CEO, business and life in Asia. And as he puts it himself, business, travel, and shabby trousers. Welcome to the show, Chris. How are you doing?
Nice one. That was such a great intro.
Well rehearsed. Where are you today?
I am at home in Tokyo.
Tokyo. What a fantastic city. How long have you been there?
I've been here, I first came here about 9 years ago, and I think I've clocked up about 6 years total time.
Right. What part of Tokyo are you living in?
I am right in the center. There's a district called Shibuya, and I'm kind of literally, that's where I live. You know the Lost in Translation, there's that scene with the really busy crossing.
The famous X-crossing, right? That's the one that everybody sort of knows about Tokyo. You live right by that, do you?
That's my hood. I live like about 10 minutes walk from there. It's kind of nice and quiet and residential where I live, but all that kind of craziness is just on my doorstep.
Did you opt for that craziness? Is that what you were looking for?
I opted for a nice, quiet, residential place just next to the craziness, yes.
Best of both worlds. So I'm just curious to know what brought you to Tokyo in the first place, because where are you from originally?
I was born in the UK and lived most of my life there. So the reason I came to Japan, it's a bit random, really. I was kind of chomping at the bit to go and live overseas, and I was looking at going to Australia, but then just quite randomly, an old school friend, there was a few of us getting together, an old school friend said, "Hey guys, let's all move to Japan." And right. I thought, Japan. Yeah, that sounds really interesting. And that was it. That was literally it.
You all did it together?
Well, no, we didn't. I was the only one that actually made it out there. Eventually, the guy who suggested it, he did come out about 3 years after me and stayed for 6 months. But it was literally that random. I guess I wanted to live overseas, and I wanted to go somewhere that was a developed country so that I would have reliable internet. Because back then, it was, reliable internet was harder to find as it is now.
True.
Yeah, it's just like I was thinking of going to a developed country, and of course, you know, Japan is a developed country, and it was totally different to anything I'd experienced before.
So what did your other friends and folks and family say when you told them that you're on this trip to Japan, and you might not come back? How did it go?
I think everyone was excited for me. My parents have done a lot of traveling themselves. They've always supported whatever crazy brain idea I've had. Generally it was kind of, you know, everyone was behind me and really everyone was like, well, when are you actually going? Because I was kind of talking about it for months before I finally booked the ticket and turned up.
And when you booked that ticket, did you book it with the intention? Was it a one-way ticket? Were you coming back? What was in your mind at the time?
This is a good question. In my mind, in the back of my mind was, I'm not coming back. But I booked a return, and I didn't tell anybody that I was going to stay. I knew it was a possibility, and I think, you know, people who knew me well probably understood that I might not be coming back. But, it was a return journey. It was meant to be like a reconnaissance mission. And then later on, you know, 6 months or a year later, I'd kind of go out for real. But I didn't. I'd 2 days after arriving, I was like, I'm just going to stay here. And I skipped my return.
So you made up your mind pretty quick. How are you going to fund yourself for that? Did you have a job before you went out there? What was the plan?
So I'd started my main business, artweb.com, literally just a few months before I went to Japan. And it wasn't really generating enough revenue to support me, but I still had a few clients that I was doing web design programming for. So I had kind of just enough money to make it happen.
So that was pretty early in the day, isn't it? I mean, we were talking, 2006, around about that?
Yeah, I think it was 2006, yeah.
Right. So you were kind of at the vanguard of location independence, even though you probably weren't thinking about it like that
at the time. Yeah, I mean, that wasn't a word then. I was like, I'm just going to go and I'm staying in Japan and I can still work. This is awesome.
Right.
It was like, there wasn't like jargon and terminology and or a community or anything. I was, you know, I was the only person. Actually, no. Here is a bit of an important backstory. I went to India like a year previously and stayed for a few weeks. And one of my friends, he was he had like a family company that he family business, and he was doing like the website of it. And him and his wife and their young baby had decided to just base themselves in India for the summer, or the winter. And I saw him sat there with his laptop in India, doing yoga, going to the beach, and I thought, man, I could do that as well.
Mm-hmm.
So, but apart from that, that was my only exposure to the idea of living and working remotely.
So when you arrived, you were still, you had your art web business going. How did you find life in Tokyo? Because it's, I know it's an expensive city. It's probably not as expensive as London, but any city that's a new city or one you're not familiar with is always more expensive than what the locals pay for, isn't it? So when you started out there, how did you get by?
So, yeah, I guess the cost was like the least of the difficulties, because actually at that time, the yen was at its weakest it's been for ages. So it was at that time, 2006, Tokyo was particularly cheap.
Mm-hmm.
It was more just like, you know, Japan is just such a kind of such a distant culture to anywhere else in the world. You know, it's unique amongst Asian countries, and you know, Asian culture is already quite different from Western culture, and you know, Japanese culture is then different again from Asian culture. So just like fitting into this place where there weren't many foreigners, where people didn't really speak English, where it was all kind of you know, quite bizarre. It was a challenge, but it was a fun challenge. You know, I was really up for the challenge. And I think, like, for the first 6 months at least, it was all kind of really exciting and really interesting.
Did you have any episodes of culture shock? Because I remember you and I met for a coffee whilst I was in Tokyo. We were talking about our experiences there. And I was sort of in, I'd spent some time in Tokyo in the 90s. And what you sort of described is that excitement, that euphoria that you get when you initially arrive. And then I find that sort of wears off after a while. And then you hit sort of one or two instances of a culture shock. I know a lot of people talk about these things, but until it actually happens to you, it's kind of strange. My incident was I walked into a supermarket, Tokyo Hands.
Yeah.
And I tried to order a plastic bag. And I didn't know the word for bag. Actually, my coworker had misinformed me that the Japanese word for bag was bagu, which it quite plainly isn't. But I was standing there shouting at this young girl who must have been a high school girl, poor girl, just going, bagu, bagu. And she at the point, I just dropped my stuff and walked out after six months there. But I stayed in Japan, but that was my culture shock. Did you have it that bad? Did you get anything like that?
Yeah, I suppose I was prepared to be shocked. So I was actually surprised that there wasn't like this big sort of slap in the face shock at any point, because I, you know, everyone told me that it was going to be quite different, and I'd met some Japanese people before I went, so I was kind of prepared for things to be weird. But I know what you mean. It's like after you know, 6 months, a year, even like up to now, there's like these kind of background things which like. You know, it's not like I ever had this big moment of culture shock. It's just like this kind of small, it's like, yeah, like just trying to get a bag and like, it doesn't work. It's like, why does this not work? And,
but you're doing all right. Yeah. You've been there for 9 years. So the proof is in the pudding, isn't it?
Yeah.
And you've got some interesting businesses going on. Let's talk about that, because you've obviously expanded out from ArtWeb. You've got your, the main website, which is Tokyo Cheapo, which is a great resource for anybody both traveling to and living in Tokyo about how to do it on the cheap, really, you know, not necessarily paying top dollar, top yen for living in Tokyo, which is great. It's a great resource. And then you've got Hobo CEO, your podcast, your radio show, which is the first time that I found out about you, and a number of other things going on. So talk about what sort of gets you out of bed in the morning. Talk about your business life with us.
Yeah. Oh, God, there's multiple things. It's like, this is the problem I'm sure a lot of entrepreneurs to relate to. You know, there's the term serial entrepreneur. I think it's better or more applicable to the people I know anyway, the term parallel entrepreneur.
Yeah.
You've got fingers in multiple pies at any given moment. And so, yeah, so there's kind of multiple things pulling my attention every day. I try to, you know, I try to kind of partition my attention. So like, okay, right, this morning I'm focused on this task for this business. This afternoon I'm going to go and finish up that task. That works quite well, kind of like, because it keeps things interesting if you're kind of shifting your brain cells around a variety of different topics. But
don't you think that parallel entrepreneur is good for creative types like yourself, though? I think that's kind of, we live in an era where it's possible, don't we, that you don't have to, I mean, starting a business isn't as expensive or risky as it used to be.
Yeah, totally. I mean, this is a big thing for me. I think that it's very sensible to tinker, to try lots of different things. Because really, all of my income now, all the revenue I've made, which, you know, is substantial now, it's worth well over $1 million in revenue, it's come from side projects. It's come from things that I was fiddling with on the side. So, you know, ArtWeb was the first thing that I was, my work was being a freelance web developer. And in my spare time, I was like, oh yeah, let's try making this. And that kind of went well. Same with Tokyo Cheapo. Like, you know, I already had ArtWeb as my main business, but I was, me and my friend, we came up with this idea of, you know, addressing the issue of Tokyo, everyone thinking Tokyo is expensive, but it's not. And, or it's not that expensive. And hence Tokyo Cheapo was born, and you know that's taken off as well. So I think it's you know, it's a really good takeaway is to keep trying things, you know, to keep trying the side projects, to keep tinkering.
Do you feel like those side projects are almost, they pick themselves in a way? You have this kind of idea and it just has to happen. I mean, how does that actually happen with you in terms of, you know, deciding on a new business or a new project? Because you probably had plenty which didn't make the cut, right?
Yeah. I think it's quite random, really. Like, you know, you can think about good business models. You can look for opportunities. You can think, right, okay, well, e-commerce, that's a, you know, that's a growing market. I think I should do something in e-commerce. And you can kind of plan your opportunities, but it's, I think it's just like you stumble across them ultimately. You can maybe like use your planning to help help you from pursuing like fruitless opportunities. But, you know, the Tokyo Cheapo, it's so random. Like, I think, you know, me and my friend Greg, we just kind of are hanging out one afternoon talking about business ideas. And, you know, we've discussed probably at least five. And both of us had coincidentally been thinking about the idea of some sort of Tokyo on the cheap type content. And we're like, yeah, well, that would be easy. We just have to throw up a blog. And it was so kind of inconsequential. So, you know, it wasn't like we'd been thinking about it for years and planning it and done a lot of analysis. It's like, yeah, well, let's give it a shot. And, you know, it took off from there.
And it's a hugely successful website, right? It's, you know,
certainly
it's cornered
a
niche.
Certainly in terms of traffic, it's successful.
What sort of traffic do you get on that website?
It's about 150,000 unique visitors a month.
Right. Fantastic. That's really, you know, that is the kind of thing that a lot of travel bloggers, I suppose, dream about. I suppose that's the key, isn't it? Is that it's not a travel blog, really, is it? You know, you're focusing on a very specific niche.
It's like a magazine, I suppose. It's because we've got like multiple people writing for it, and it's kind of practical information. It's like there's not so many kind of, I don't know, like reflections on 12 days in Cambodia. It's
right.
It's like, yeah, how to get to the airport to the center of the city, how to buy a SIM card. It's a lot of it's just like really kind of functional information. And so the word blog perhaps is slightly misleading.
One thing I like about you, Chris, is one thing that impresses me about you, and I think I got this impression from when I met you, is you like to experiment. I get the impression that you're always trying new things. And I get that impression as well from reading your stories on your blogs as well.
Yeah.
You know, just like recently doing the fast and stuff like that.
Yeah.
It seems like you're always trying. I don't know. What's the drive here? What are you trying to discover with all this stuff? What is that drive that thinks, yeah, I'm going to do this. I'm going to try this thing out. It doesn't seem like you're content with just sort of staying still.
Yeah, I think I'm just predisposed to tinkering and trying things and creating things. They say that, you know, some people are good at starting things. Some people are good at like running and optimizing things, and some people are good at finishing things. And I'm definitely in the former category. I see the amount of kind of like, the graveyard of unfinished projects that I have. It's like much bigger than what you actually see. That's actually kind of, you know, out there and successful.
But does that then require you to hook up to find people who have the other skills? Because I imagine if you're good at starting something and that thing is good, then you're going to need somebody to work with who can kind of take you to that next stage, right?
Yeah, it would certainly help me to find people who are better at finishing and running things. That's something I look for. I'm kind of okay. Like, you know, it's not like I can only start things. I can continue running things, but it's good to recognize, to understand what you are like and what your predispositions are, and to, you know, that helps you understand what you're capable of and what you're not capable of, and what you should hire people for, what you should get partners for.
In the context of running a business, so you're understanding what type of entrepreneur you are and sort of what your strengths and weaknesses are. Yeah, that makes sense, doesn't it?
Because, I mean, it's, you get like a technical founder, then you get like the kind of marketing founder. It's, it's a little bit weak if you're both technical founders, for example. There's plenty of successful businesses where the founders have a similar skill set, but it's good to partner up with people who have a complementary set of skills.
Yeah, for sure. So let's talk about being a businessman, an entrepreneur in Tokyo. What's that like? I mean, a lot of people talk about Tokyo in the context of technology and all the innovation. But, you know, there's a lot of the other side of Tokyo and living in Japan, which, you know, faces the entrepreneur, which is probably the unsaid stuff, like the bureaucracy and so on. What's it actually like? I know we've got on this about faxes. I don't know if we're going to get to that in a minute, but what's it actually like as an entrepreneur working in Tokyo?
Well, I think what you just mentioned, fax, that's a really good place to start. Like the fact that the fax is still well alive and in use in Tokyo. It's alive and well still to this day. Tells you a lot about what the business climate is like here. There's a lot of like bureaucracy, as you mentioned. There's a lot of sort of traditional attitudes, and frankly, it's a very difficult place to do business. And most of the time I've been here, the revenue for me has come from ArtWeb, which has actually got nothing to do with Japan, really. So I've basically really stayed on the fringes of the business world here. And obviously Tokyo Cheapo has brought me much closer to it, but it's so frustrating because everything's done in a very Japanese way, which means it's very difficult if you're a foreign entrepreneur, because either you need Japanese help, you need somebody on your team to kind of go there and wear the suit and exchange the business cards and to speak the ultra polite Japanese, or you can try and do it yourself, or you're just kind of like, I guess, limiting your opportunities.
I guess most people would think, though, that you could, from the images of Japan, that you could do everything online at the touch of a button, right?
It's funny. It's I think that reputation is maybe fading a bit. But, you know, Japan was the powerhouse of technology in the 80s and the early 90s, you know, with Sony, Panasonic, all these technology giants. But, that's really a faded era. The internet in Japan is way behind the Western internet. They say it's about, in general, the Japanese internet is about 5 years behind what's happening in the rest of the world.
Wow.
So it's like... the fax machine is still going strong.
It won't die.
No.
No, I remember my time in, even in the 90s, Chris, faxes in the offices. So I can remember walking into my manager's office and just, it was a tiny little corridor type thing, and just had a fax machine in there. Like the whole thing was just full up with reams and reams of paper spewed out from the fax.
Yeah.
It was popular back then.
Yeah, it's crazy. Like, I was having dinner with somebody last year, a Japanese lady who, a New Yorker stroke Japanese woman, and she'd recently relocated to Tokyo. And she said, I couldn't believe it. Somebody said to me, can you fax me your email address?
Oh, wow. Yeah, no, that's so true. Okay, well, let's not dwell on the faxes. Let's talk about the upside of being in a city like Tokyo as an entrepreneur. Because, you know, away from the bureaucracy, there must be something really exciting about living in a place where things, I guess, are a little bit unfamiliar, but then you're sort of in a network of people in a similar situation. And that must be quite a buzz, isn't it, that you've got this group of people, all who have made the effort to leave their countries of origin, you know, come to somewhere new, a new start and so on. What's that actually like? You know, just give us a feel for the kind of business and social scene going on there.
So because it's quite a tricky place to come to, you know, it's dead easy to go somewhere like Thailand where it's really cheap. And, you know, there's the kind of backpacker stroke newbie traveler entrepreneur types. Because Japan's like a kind of step above that, you know, it's a little, it's more expensive. There's more kind of, the puzzle you have to figure out before you can actually live and stay here. Because of that, I think that there's this sort of filter, and it means that all the expat friends I have here, generally they're really motivated, they're really smart, they're doing, you know, some amazing things. Although it's quite a small scene, there's not actually that many foreigners here. The people in it, you know, it's this very high density of really interesting, smart, and motivated people. So to give you an example, like, you know, my friends in Tokyo, most of them are some sort of entrepreneur. I know, like, multiple people who run agencies, digital agencies. You know, they've got, like, offices with lots of staff. I've got two of my friends founded this really big startup. You might even have heard it, Gengo.com.
Mm-hmm.
It's a kind of language translation thing. And they've got like office in Silicon Valley, Tokyo, London. So like these are just like my friends. You know, we just kind of met at like, you know, internet networking event like 6 years ago or something. And pretty much everybody I know is, you know, has gone on to do a pretty impressive business. And so I think it's like... you know, the kind of people you meet here is, I just, you know, I spent time in other Asian cities and I just kind of always find, I hate to, it sounds a bit snobby, but it's like there's a sort of better class of expat.
A more distinguished expat.
Yeah.
Worth it for that though, isn't it? I mean, the whole, whether you do go to somewhere like Chiang Mai or go to Tokyo, you know, the fact that you're surrounded by these people is probably the main reason why, you know, you can make business a success there, isn't it? It's not necessarily the fact that you've got access to all this infrastructure or it's cheaper than back home or that kind of thing. It's the fact you've got this peer group, which I suppose is quite motivating as well, that, you know, if you were to stay at home, you'd have been surrounded by people you would have known for years and years and grown up with, you know, not necessarily the most conducive to starting a business, especially for somebody like yourself, who probably just needs to be able to, you know, have an outlet for your ideas.
Yeah, totally. I think one of the most toxic things you can do is like expect your, you know, your original peer group to, you know, support you and come with you on the journey. It's sadly, you know, humans have this sort of tendency to try and pull you back to how you were. And not everybody's like that, but I definitely resonate with what you just said, like kind of moving away from the UK, living in these other cities, meeting all these other people who are doing inspiring things, that's a huge help. And I think if I hadn't done it, you know, it might really have held me back.
That's an interesting point, isn't it? Well, on that point about your original peer group, do they ever say, Chris, when are you coming back? You've had your fun.
Well, I think that kind of, that moment's come and gone. It's been like a good 9 years. So I guess most of the people I knew in the UK were kind of crazy weirdo artists, people like myself. So I think I've been quite fortunate. I've still got to, you know, good connections, and like most of the people have been cheering me on rather than like kind of when you're coming back to the pub and it's like, I guess that's kind of if that moment was ever there, it's kind of gone now, you know, it's been like 9 years.
And the long term, 9 years, can you see another 9 years in Tokyo? What's the plans? Do you have plans or are you just taking it as it comes?
This is a good question. I think it's one people who are kind of maybe at the beginning of their journey are curious about. What kind of happens, as maybe you can relate to, Graham, is after a certain point, you don't really think in terms of, oh, I'm going to go back home. It's like, you know, what was home is just another location that you can live. And I'm like, yeah, I've really no idea where I'll be in nine years' time. It could well be Tokyo. I love Tokyo. It's a great place. But equally, it could be Berlin. It could be, I don't know, maybe a new place. It's difficult to really think in those terms.
No, that's a good point. That whole idea of what home is, as you say, after a point, you sort of redefine what it is. And I think at the same time, you know, it can be quite liberating in a way. And at the same time, there's the flip side of that, that you feel that, well, I'm not actually based anyway, really, you know, long term, apart from where I am. And I think, you know, the other side of that is, I wonder if this ever affects you, is the fact that because you have chosen to live somewhere else, because you can choose to live anywhere, that you can sometimes get a little bit restless. Does that ever affect you at all? Do you thinking, well, you know, how about that, looks like a nice city, I can go and live there, because you've done it once already. Yeah. Why not do it again?
Yeah, there's definitely a downside to this. And I'd say it's more in terms of what it does to your thinking. It's like, for example, I could go back and live in the UK. It's conceivable. I could sort of quote unquote go back home, but, I couldn't change my mindset. You know, I've irreversibly changed the way I see the world. And, that's a good thing. Overall, that's a good thing, but it does have the slight kind of negative of, it's quite a unique way of seeing the world, because most people tend to live out their lives in a specific locale and have, you know, their mindset is keyed into a certain area. You know, I belong here. This is my people. Now I've kind of, you know, my mind's been opened, and it's difficult to go back to that, because I did go back and live in London for a year, a few years back. And, it was actually quite difficult to fit in, because although I was English and had the sort of, you know, the Southern English accent, I wasn't really seeing the world in the way most of the other English people were. So I tended to gravitate towards, my friends were like Australian or, you know, Eastern European.
That's an interesting point. I'm kind of trying to tune into what you're saying there. It's like, you know, you're saying that because you've lived somewhere for some time, you're not sort of bound to the way that people used to think from where you came, right? In the sense that there's a certain way that they're expected to behave or think or so on. You know, did you find that when you moved back, people were interested in things like celebrity and stuff like that, and you just thought, well, you know, I don't give a crap about this?
Yeah, totally. It's
What's on TV or what this person's doing and so on.
I guess I'd already stopped watching TV when I was young. So I was already, you know, like when I was living in Brighton before I came to Japan, you know, Brighton's a pretty kind of out there crazy city full of artists and musicians and all kinds of weird and wonderful people. So I kind of feel in a sense that I was already a little bit different. But yeah, certainly, you know, like kind of seeing other parts of the world, as I was saying, it kind of irreversibly changes the way you see the world. And it's kind of, like you talk about TV and celebrities and stuff like Christmas, you know, I'm like, I just don't get it. It's like, it seems like such a silly thing now. And, you know, all this sort of fuss about giving presents and having a turkey. I don't know if I'm allowed to swear on your podcast.
Go for it. Censoring my I'll put the explicit turkey thing on it.
But it's like there's all these kind of traditional British behaviors and events and things which you know, like in Tokyo, there's no Christmas. It doesn't exist here. It's a normal work day, and it's just kind of having these juxtapositions, having this different perspective. It's impossible for me to now just kind of like you know, join the group. I mean, I can still play along. You know, sometimes I'm back in the UK and it's Christmas and yeah, but it's like I don't feel like it's something that I have to do anymore. I'm like, you know, I've basically thrown the rule book away and I'm writing my own rules, and yeah, so, you know, it's like I take it or leave it, certain things from the culture that I was born in.
That's great. That's what it's all about, Chris. You know, I admire you for saying that. And I think that's kind of one of the key things of travel, isn't it? Because that's the opening your mind part, isn't it? Because then you realize,
Totally.
Actually, you were living kind of an illusion, weren't you, in the life before we all were. And now we can pick and choose what really, what's real.
It's an opening mind thing. I think, really, it's probably one of the most valuable things anybody can do in this day and age is to travel more, because it's gonna open your mind, and that has such a positive effect. Helps you see what's real, you know, as you just said.
Well, Chris, I've really enjoyed talking to you today. Thousands of miles away, but you sound like you're sitting across the table from me here in Spain. Modern technology is amazing. Where can we find out more about Mr. Kirkland? Where do we go to find out more about your story?
MrKirkland.com is a good landing point. That's where I kind of link to all the different projects I'm involved in. But obviously TokyoCheapo.com. That's if you're interested in Tokyo. ArtWeb.com if you're interested in art. And, I suppose I should drop a mention. With Tokyo Cheapo, we're doing a crowdfunding campaign. So if you are interested in Tokyo, then TokyoCheapo.com/book. And get our guide on how to visit Tokyo on a pittance.
That's a great starting point. That was Chris Kirkland, everybody. World traveler, entrepreneur, author, radio show, musician, and hobo CEO. And, of course, Mr. Kirkland. We'll be speaking to him, I'm sure, in 6 to 12 months from now. Just catch up on the journey and see what's going on in the world of Chris Kirkland. Chris, thank you very much for joining us on the show.
Thanks for having me, Graham. I look forward to coming back.
Barefoot Radio. Want to know how to live the location-independent lifestyle? Then find out more at www.barefootjournal.com.